Welcome to the Endometriosis VAP. My name is Taylor Turner. I'm currently a resident in obstetrics and gynecology at Duke University Medical Center. As with most lectures, we'll cover the basics important for medical students, a little physiology, the diagnostic criteria, and treatment strategies. We'll also talk about the conditions associated with endometriosis that may actually be the reason your patients present, since many patients have no idea they suffer from endometriosis. Which patients should make you think this woman may have endometriosis? The most common presentations are painful periods or dysmenorrhea. It's important to distinguish the cyclical pelvic pain patient from a woman that has pain all the time or even irregularly. Endometriosis is a disease whose symptoms most frequently associate with menses. Additionally, an endometriosis patient may have infertility and nothing else. Don't forget, though, that like many diseases, there are women who meet the diagnosis of endometriosis but actually have no symptoms. We'll talk later about how you would make that diagnosis. Traditionally, the classic triad pictured here is associated with endometriosis: painful intercourse, painful menses, and infertility. But of course, your patients will each have their own particular clinical picture. Now that you understand the symptoms, you may suspect your patient has endometriosis. But once you tell her, the first question back often is, what is it? The shortest description is written here, but in layman's terms, the lining of the uterus is outside the uterus and growing where it shouldn't. If you think about all the changes the endometrium goes through, thickening, changing from proliferative to secretory, any implants of endometrium will do the same in some manner and cause significant inflammation wherever they've landed. Thus, dysmenorrhea is a typical sign of the disease. These implants can land nearly anywhere within the abdomen, ovaries, bowel, perimetrium, fallopian tubes, and deep in the pelvic cul-de-sac. The dark and brownish spots on this photo are sites of implantation in the peritoneum. The color typically comes from menstrual bleeding that has no passage out of the body due to implantation outside of the uterus. So your patient will continue to have regular periods with irregular bleeding, but her endometriosis sites will also cycle each month and cause symptoms. So how did these cells of endometrium escape the uterus and stick elsewhere? We don't know for sure, but there are several important theories. The easiest to understand is retrograde menstruation. As the endometrium is shed each cycle, some cells may move in the wrong direction, through the fallopian tubes and out into the abdominal cavity. This theory may explain why the ovaries are the most common site of endometriosis implants, due to their close proximity to the fimbriae of the fallopian tube, and why endometriosis is more common in women with outflow tract obstructions that prevent normal menstrual bleeding. There also appears to be a genetic predisposition in endometriosis, which could explain why some women suffer from the disease despite normal anatomy. Another important theory is that all of the pelvic endometrium retains the capacity to develop into endometrial tissue at later dates. The take-home message is, multiple theories exist to explain endometriosis, but the true answer is unknown. Many of you will be familiar with the concept of a gold standard diagnosis. In the case of endometriosis, the sole definitive manner of diagnosing the disease is visualization and pathologic examination of tissue samples. The appearance of lesions can vary widely. A ruptured chocolate cyst, or endometriompa, is seen on the left. It formed as endometrial tissue bled, formed a cyst, clotted, and eventually ruptured. The right image shows smaller implants, similar to those seen earlier. Obviously, this poses a problem for our hypothetical patient. She likely already suffers from pelvic pain, and a firm diagnosis requires invasive surgery, which brings its own risks, including pain, both postoperatively and long-term due to adhesion formation. So while the gold standard is laparoscopy, many times treatment will be initiated without a true pathologic diagnosis. It's important to discuss two conditions associated with endometriosis because their presence or absence will impact those treatment strategies that we try to implement. The first is infertility. Endometriosis appears to produce an inflammatory or immunologic response that affects fertility. For those with mild disease, pro-fertility drug regimens may allow them to conceive, but more advanced or widespread disease should be resected surgically to improve fertility. A second important consideration is pelvic pain. Pain is a common symptom of endometriosis, but many other things can cause pelvic pain. Interabdominal adhesions are an important possible source. Adhesions often form in response to inflammation within the peritoneum and may form in response to endometriosis alone. At the time of surgery, these could be removed, but surgery itself is a significant risk factor for adhesion formation. This puts you in a difficult conundrum. I saw a patient in her early 20s with a high clinical suspicion of endometriosis, cyclical pain, positive family history, etc. She wanted surgery because she thought it would solve her problem. But what if I didn't find anything to remove or to resect? Should I just explore her pelvis laparoscopy? Manipulating her pelvic organs causes an increased risk of adhesions with the accompanying pelvic pain. It's important to remember these associated conditions because they, in and of themselves, are difficult entities to treat and must be considered when evaluating a woman with endometriosis. Now we're back in clinic. Having tentatively diagnosed our patient with endometriosis, explained to her what it is, it's time to figure out a treatment plan. Understanding each patient's goals is the key in planning treatment. The simplest case is a woman who has the symptoms and does not desire pregnancy at this time. For her plan, we need to remember the pathophysiology. She has endometrial tissue outside the uterus that is changing with each menstrual cycle and causing resultant inflammation. So our goal is to stop the cycle, stop the stimulation of that tissue, and some of the inflammation and pain hopefully will resolve. On the next slide, we'll describe how to do this, but remember, stop the cycle, stop the bleeding at the implantation site, and many patients will have decreased pain while on those medications. If this patient is trying to become pregnant, then stopping her cycle is clearly not a good plan. Surgery has been shown to improve fertility, so if lesions are seen at laparoscopy, they should be ablated, typically with laser ablation. Large endometriomas should also be removed. It is important to tell this patient beforehand that such a surgery may increase her chances of successful pregnancy, but there is no guarantee. Long-term treatment in patients who are through with childbearing opens more options, ranging from long-term medical treatments to hysterectomy with salpingo-oophorectomy. Treatments for endometriosis are either surgical or based on each patient's situation, as I described earlier. The medical therapies all aim to cause amenorrhea and are very effective while being taken, but symptom recurrence can be expected once they are stopped. The options listed here are all effective, though danazol is no longer used commonly due to androgenic side effects, including acne, hirsutism, and weight gain. Surgical options are virtually always via laparoscopy, and there are various ways to remove lesions. These include laser ablation, electrocautery, and sharp excision. There is, of course, another group of patients who present with symptoms consistent with endometriosis. 42-year-old female with 3 living children who has completed her childbearing may want definitive treatment. The risk profile of surgery should always direct starting with medical therapy, but if that fails, such a patient may want removal of her uterus and all visible endometriosis lesions. If the ovaries are left in situ, medical suppression after surgery would be recommended because it's always possible you missed a small implant at the time of surgery and continued stimulation from the ovaries will cause continued inflammation and pain. In summary, endometriosis at its most basic level is caused by endometrial tissue that is implanted, growing, and cycling outside of the uterus. The medical comorbidities are extremely important to consider, both in making the diagnosis, counseling your patient, and treatment. And those same comorbidities may determine your treatment goals and strategy. Now, the definitive therapy is surgical, but for many patients, that's simply not an option. References are listed here. And a special acknowledgement goes to Dr. Elizabeth Livingston for her help in preparing this presentation. Thank you.